I call the second pillar of calculus track the changes. It's a pretty good strategy in the real world to keep track of how much things are changing. You can't really keep track of the entire world all the time. In fact, the way that you see things around you, your eye is only focused on one little thing, and your brain remembers what the rest of your visual field is. Every once in a while, you check to see if anything's changed, but that's the way we deal with the world. The same thing goes for math. If you've got a function, so here we got a function. One of the most basic questions you can ask about that function is, how fast is it changing? Right? Over here, it's going up at a pretty good clip. Here, it stopped going up, and it doesn't seem to be changing at all. Well, it's at a maximum. It used to be going up, now it's going down. We'll talk more about maxima and minima later on. Here, it's going down. Here, it's flattened out again. Here, it's going up. And one of the basic questions you can ask is, how fast is a function changing? So this is half of all of calculus. So if f of f is a function, the derivative, which we write f prime of x, or sometimes we write it as df dx, or sometimes we write it as dy dx, they all mean the same thing, is how fast f is changing. So, how do we go about figuring out how fast things are changing? Well, if things changed at a constant rate, it would be pretty darn easy. You know, if you were driving in a car and you'd gone 150 miles in the last 2 hours and you were going at constant speed, you'd know you're going at 75 miles an hour. You're typically not going at constant speed. So let's suppose that you're driving along in a car and you look in the rearview mirror and there's a cop and you're wondering, uh-oh, am I in trouble? And your speedometer's broken. But you got a buddy in the front seat and your buddy is compulsive and he's been, you know, looking at the mile markers and the tenth of the miles markers and, you know, all the markings along the side of the road, and he's got a stopwatch, and he loves doing calculations, and you're going to try to figure out how fast are you going. So the first thing your buddy tells you is that in the last hour, you've gone 75 miles. So how fast are you going? Well, you don't know, but you know that for the last hour, you've been averaging 75 miles an hour. Now, maybe that's because a little while ago, you were on a toll road with a speed limit of 80, and now you're going slower. So you don't really know how fast you're going right now, but you know that in the last hour, you've averaged 75 miles an hour. Now, you don't want to give too much weight to what happened half an hour ago, so you get a better estimate by looking at what happened over the last 10 minutes. If over the last 10 minutes, you went 11 miles, well, in the last 10 minutes, you were averaging 66 miles an hour. That's a better guess of how fast you're going right now than averaging over the last hour. Maybe over the last 5 minutes, you went 5.25 miles. The last 5 minutes, you've been averaging 63 miles an hour. Maybe over the last minute, you've been averaging 61.2 miles an hour. If you average over shorter and shorter periods of time, you get a better and better sense of what your speed is right now. But can you average over zero time? Can you figure out your speed right now by saying, how fast have I gone right now divided by how long it took? That doesn't make sense. You get zero over zero. So the way that you get all of these changes is by taking a limit. You say, what was your average speed for the last hour, the last 10 minutes, last 5 minutes, last minute, last 10 seconds, 1 second, tenth of a second? And you take a limit. In this case, it sure looks like the limit is 60 miles an hour. And as long as you're not doing this on Shoal Creek Boulevard, you're probably pretty safe from the cop. In general, the way we do this in calculus is we've got a function. We say, let's take the function a second from now, or a minute from now, or in general, a time h from now, and divide it by h. This is the average rate of change between x and x plus h. So we've got our curve. Here's x, and here's x plus h, and we figure out what the rate of change is in between, and that's a slope. And then if we want the change right now, we take a limit. We average over shorter and shorter and shorter periods of time, and we call that our derivative. We can't plug in h equals 0. That doesn't make any sense. You'd get 0 divided by 0. You can take a limit as you get closer and closer and closer.